Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Sky Sports F1 podcast with me, Matt Baker. One race down, 23 to go, and a very warm welcome to our hotel here in Bahrain with our esteemed guests, David Croft, Naomi Schiff, and Simon Lazenby. Hello. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm very well. How is everyone else?
Fine.
Good.
I mean, you mentioned we're at the hotel, but we're actually at the pool, the hotel. Yes. Hence, Crofty and I are in our sandals.
You didn't tell me it was going to be by the pool, which is why I don't know why I've got my jeans on.
Yeah, we look like we're going to the pub and these guys look like they're on holiday.
It's flip-flop day. And whilst Naomi's stocks are amazing, we like her flip-flops, they haven't got a bottle opener on the sole. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the future of flip-flop technology.
It is very cool.
Yeah.
I didn't even realise that those things existed.
Wow.
Flip-flops with a bottle opener.
Very, very useful indeed.
And well done to you, by the way, yesterday.
On
the golf course yesterday.
Oh, well,
massive shouts on the second hole.
Yeah.
A lot of commotion.
Almost a hole in one.
By about that much,
really?
He missed a hole in one. Matt Baker, who wanted to play off 40 because he said he was that bad, almost hit a hole in one. Unbelievable.
Look, it was a great moment in my golfing career. And I will clip this up and tell everyone I've ever played golf with, this is how I played, because they won't believe.
Now playing off two.
Yeah. And then there was the other 17 holes.
Yeah, there was some really bad stuff. Yeah. Anyway, let's not talk about that. Right, a lot to get through, but we're going to keep going. This went down very well last week with Nat, Kareen, and with Tomo. What did we learn over the last week in Formula One? Crofty, start with you.
That you should pay attention to our testing coverage when we tell the world that Red Bull might have a decent car. that came true. What I also learned, and I had to write this down, that there are 330 species of birds in Bahrain. We knew that. And I know furry mammals is your usual
specialty. It is, but I'm also quite into birds.
The national bird of Bahrain is the white-cheeked bulbul, which I thought was quite appropriate. For this weekend, the white-cheeked bulbul, ladies and gentlemen, eats fruits, rather fond of dates. And I'm just searching for my phone. I have got a picture on my phone. I thought I'd show you of the aforementioned white-cheeked bulbul. There you go. Look, a lovely little bird that is.
Oh, that's cute. Looks like it really has white cheeks.
It does, and it looks like it's wearing a crash helmet as well.
It kind of looks like a penguin a little bit.
It does look like a reverse penguin. There you go. The white-cheeked bulbul, ladies and gentlemen. I'll tell you what, I'll enlarge that. And cameraman Pete, you might want to zoom in. And hopefully at this moment, no one's going to message me. There is the white-cheeked bulbul. That, perhaps more interesting than what happened to the white-cheeked driver in the Red Bull during the course of 57 laps, where he seemed to be in a race of his own on Saturday.
We'll get on to the race. Perhaps we'll put it down as not a classic, maybe is a polite way of putting it.
That's very tactfully put, Matt.
Thank you.
Well done.
Naomi, what have you learned this week in Formula One?
Slightly bizarre fact, but I had an interview with both of the Haas drivers on whatever day of the week it was. I think it was Friday night after qualifying. And, you know, they've both got their really cute, adorable daughters in the paddock every weekend. So I asked the question, do you guys share a room or do you have separate rooms? Because I'm assuming sleep is incredibly important for your performance, right? And they both stay in a room with their kids. And Kevin actually mentioned that he's obviously got two kids now. One is very little and wakes up a few times in the night. So he's given the bed to his wife and kids and he sleeps on the couch in the living room.
Wow.
Wow.
Wow, guys.
There's that.
Well, you've learned something.
Yeah. Basically, as a man who's slept on the couch from time to time in his life, how comfortable a night is Kevin Magnussen having?
Not very.
Very very gentlemanly, though, of him.
Yeah. I'm sure we could get two rooms if you wanted. But
probably.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know.
Cost cap,
Matt. Stay in the family. Cost cap.
Yeah, bites deep.
Go on, Simon. Finally, what have you learned?
Well, I mean, Adrian Newey is quite good, is what I've learned this weekend. And I think that car is possibly better than last year's car. In fact, it's definitely better than last year's car. It's amazing. I think we are... How do we put this? I think that the others are going to have to be on absolute top form on any given weekend to have any chance of beating that RB20 because it's amazing. It's just a piece of art. It looks like a fighter jet, as we've been saying all weekend, and I think he's done it again. And, you know, I was talking to a few people from Red Bull on Saturday night, Sunday, and they were just, yeah, this is very, very, very good. And I think we're gonna probably...
And for them to have hit the ground running. Yeah, I mean, with a car that doesn't look much like their car last year, some people are still, you know, experimenting with their new concepts and getting to know their cars, and they've just come out the gates flying. So yeah, absolutely, it's slightly scary, isn't it?
And it's a double-edged attack as well. It's not just the speed and the pace of the car. It is that reliability. Mm. And that reliability for driver and car that we've seen stretching all the way back to Australia 2022 now. The last race that Max Verstappen didn't finish. I think it's 40 Grand Prix in a row now that he's mainly won or finished on the podium, but scored points in two. And that would be the worry for the chasing pack for me. When are they going to have a bad run of reliability? Because it doesn't look like it's coming. And Max isn't making mistakes. And hand in hand, that goes together. To win your championships, you get out of it what you put in, and Red Bull are putting a lot in. And deserve that success based on their efforts from driver and team.
And let's not say it's not just Adrian Newey, by the way. It's Pierre Vacher. It's the whole design team that have put this together. It's more of a collective effort. And I know that they think within Red Bull, yes, Adrian is the top man still, but it is a collective, isn't it?
It is. And short of putting a wheel clamp on Max's car at the start, I'm not quite sure how the rest catch up really quickly, to be fair. But I'm going to say this, and I think it's important to note, it's only one race down.
Absolutely.
It's only one type of track. Jeddah next week is a different type of track altogether. Australia is a different track, as is Japan, as is China. Once we've had five races, and Red Bull have won all five, then we can definitely say, you know, this is the car. So I think there's a lot to come between now and writing this season off. And we shouldn't write this season off just yet. It is only one race.
Reasons to be optimistic. We're going to come on to a few more as well a little bit later. Just while we're here, you kind of nicked my what I learned, because I was going to say...
Oh, did you know the white-cheeked bull as well?
No. Not that one. The reliability factor. All 20 cars finished for the first time in history in the opening race for Formula One weekend, which we've never had before. And I think that just, you know, this might be the most reliable season of Formula One cars in the history of Formula
One. As it should be, because the regulations haven't exactly changed much from last year. And last year was pretty reliable as well. I think the days of, you know, only half the field finishing a Formula One race for the time being are long gone, which is great because we've seen more action. Well, I'd like to see 20 cars on track. What about you?
I agree. I mean, this weekend we barely had many yellow flags. We hardly had anything, really. It all was very,
Bert
very
Mylander.
Smooth. And I understand.
Bert Mylander should feel embarrassed taking a paycheck after this weekend. He's done nothing.
He's not done much, but he's been on high alert at all points.
Yes.
No, I think obviously we want to see cars racing on track. That's the priority. But if we've not got that happening very much, and there is still some pretty interesting racing along the pack, maybe, you know, it's all overshadowed by the performance of that Red Bull at the front. But if we're going to have slightly predictable racing at the moment, then why not throw some spanners in the work or some unreliability or some...
But as a driver, you've said that with with reliability. Would you not, as a driver, be so frustrated by reliability problems?
Of course.
So yeah.
Yeah, no, look, I'm not saying that we're all wishing for reliability issues. I think it's great that the teams have got their cars to this place where they are so solid, and now they just need to work on the aspect of making that pack even closer than it is. It has got closer already, and we saw that in qualifying. Some of the gaps are really, really small. I mean, from P2 to P9 was just under 0.3, or just over 0.3. So that worked itself out to be 0.02 of a second per corner. There's 15 corners on this track. And I mean, I don't know if you can even blink that fast, Matt, but it's really nothing if you take it corner by corner. So that's also a bit of a silver lining here. That is happening, but we need to see more of it.
I think what we're saying is it's really, really close, apart from that bit from the chasing pack to Max.
Exactly.
That's the gap that I think everyone would love to see come down.
Mm. So when we put up a question to ask for questions about the race and the Bahrain Grand Prix, a lot of people on Twitter and Instagram were asking the question, how have Red Bull got a car so dominant? And I just want to unpack that a little bit. Simon, start with you. What things have happened in Formula One to allow Red Bull to be in the position, and mainly Max Verstappen, to be in the position that they are now? Because a lot of fans are going, hold on a minute, this is just domination. This isn't as exciting as it was a few years ago. Obviously, we had 2021, which is perhaps the best Formula One season ever. So how have we got here?
When you go back to 2021, a lot of people would disagree with you saying the best season ever because of what happened at the last race. But what I think, we had this with Mercedes, and we've had it with Schumacher, we've had it with Vettel. You go through a period of regulations where one team is so dominant that it just carries on. And I think that, again, we go to Newey, we go to ground effect, and he's the master of the ground effect era of cars. And he got it right at the start, and it carried through, and they've just been allowed to stay one step ahead because just of the fact that, yes, there's the law of diminishing returns, which will bring other people into it as we get towards the last stage, which is why 2021, we had a really good title race, wasn't it? Because it was just fixed regulations for a while. But the car was good to start with. It's carried on being good. Everyone's developed and they've stayed ahead on the conveyor belt, haven't they?
I think one of the biggest factors for them and what's really helping them with their performance here is the lack of tire deg that they have. I think Martin said in commentary that Max's set of softs were good enough to go to Jeddah. But it does make the difference. You know, we saw the gap in qualifying being smaller than it was last year. So that is something to be optimistic about. But clearly in the race, there just was no competition for them. And that comes down to multiple factors, whether it's, you know, the camber that they're running, the toe that they're running, the amount of heat that they're managing to keep in the wheel and in the hub, but also evacuating enough heat so that the tires aren't overheating. All of those small things come together, and they've really had to strike the balance. And I think, you know, as you said, it's only race one. This track has a really, really high, it's very high in tire deg. It's very abrasive. So I think that will actually get smaller, and that's something to look forward to. And last year we saw, take a look at Singapore. Not a lot of grip on the track, quite bumpy. I think as we go forwards of the season to tracks that have less tire deg, the gap will inevitably be smaller. So that's maybe a silver lining here.
You used the word balance, and I think balance was a really key word in Adrian Newey's concept for 2022. And obviously it's tempting when new regulations come in and you're designing an F1 car, you're chasing performance. You want it to be the fastest car, but Adrian understood ground effect and the consequences of it in terms of porpoising. That if you chase performance too much, you are going to get porpoising. So he designed a car that was fast, but was balanced and didn't suffer a lot of what the other teams were suffering. Mm. And we're seeing the knock-on effect of that now, because whilst other teams have cured their problems from 2022, while you're fixing the problem, while you're finding the solution, you're not enhancing the performance. There's only so much you can do during the course of a day back at base to put things right and find performance. And it's a trade-off, isn't it? One thing has to suffer at the hands of the other. So Red Bull have not had to find solutions to problems necessarily. They're just finding new answers to performance. And that's what we've seen through 22, 23, and now into 24. That is why they are still the top team.
A lot of the teams this year have gone towards what the RB19 looked like last year, haven't they?
Yeah, and the RB19 and wants to be like the Mercedes.
It's unbelievable, isn't it? And then the RB20 is just
injury.
Here. They've literally have completely changed the concept. And I say he's just a genius, isn't he?
He is.
He really is. Something you alluded to there was actually the comments from Lewis. He said after the race, he said, the past 2 years, they've had all these problems. They've spent several races undoing all the problems, as opposed to now we've got a platform we can start adding to. It's a building process and we're a great team. So, Crofty, do you think now teams like Mercedes have got a better, more stable platform to then start adding? And do you think we'll see a quicker acceleration of their development throughout the season?
Yeah, I do. And I think Mercedes, you would have seen a better Mercedes on track had they not got the cooling set up completely wrong for Bahrain. They went wrong to the extent of about 0.4 seconds a lap, and they had these big cooling issues, and George and Lewis were having to lift and coast, and by doing that they were cooling their tyres down as well, and it was a knock-on effect. Mercedes are a better package than we saw in Bahrain. I'm not quite sure.
They were disappointed, weren't they?
Yeah, they were. Tell. What happened, HPP will set the parameters on which to run the engine, and I think there was a miscalculation that wasn't argued or otherwise by the chassis team, by the team at the track setting up the car. And if that is the case, that's good, because that's not a long-term problem. It's not we've got a massive issue with the engine. It's just there was a miscalculation for that race. And Williams, I think, was suffering a bit as well, and maybe McLaren too. It wasn't just a Mercedes works team-specific problem. But yeah, their car does look a lot better. And they were second in the championship last year by a whisker. I would expect them you know, on the showing that we saw leading up to the race to be challenging for that second again. But then again, Ferrari in the race had their brake issue problems. So we didn't see the best of Ferrari. And here are your reasons to be optimistic, because the chasing pack didn't get it right in that race, did they?
And we are optimistic, folks. We are. 24 races.
No, but as Crofty says, it's not as if this is a massive fix for them. Every team, you know, it's not that they've made this fundamental development fault. It's
unlike last year.
Every team has multiple different bodywork packages when it comes to cooling. So I think for them, they just opted for something that was slightly too aggressive, and it went the wrong way. But I think next week we'll see a very different performance from them on that side. And as you say, it affected multiple teams. So, yeah.
Your knee sunburnt, by the way.
Is my knee sunburnt? Probably. I don't know. It's probably because I've actually been sat like
yeah,
this.
Yeah, it's the cross layer.
I've been sat like that.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Just checking. I should have got the jeans memo, checking. Shouldn't
yeah.
I?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You didn't
yeah,
have
yeah,
the
yeah.
right cooling package either.
Very good. Very, very
lovely
good.
Stuff.
Yeah,
lovely stuff. That'll get in the edit.
Yeah. Simon, tell us about the other teams and what you think the other teams are going to be making of what's happened at Red Bull this year. Because you look around Mercedes, for example, 8-time world champions, and that's all happened recently. They must be sitting there going, how have we got this so wrong? Because again, a lot of fans are asking that question of, obviously Max is so far ahead, but we need a closer pack, don't we? We need other drivers closer and other teams closer to give us better spectacles, better racing.
I'm not sure what we can add to that, except for Jeremy Clarkson, didn't he, on the grid was saying he'd analysed the times and it wasn't much different from last year in terms of the gaps, what they've been doing all winter. Well, they've been working really hard, but Red Bull have been working as hard of them, and they had a car that was ahead of them. So we just keep going back round to that. Will there be a situation this year where we have a McLaren or whoever it might be that develops to a point where they can, you know, find performance? Are we going to get something like that? I hope we are, but I'm not sure we are.
Well, I think we can give them somewhat the benefit of the doubt. I mean, yes, they are an extremely experienced and successful team in Formula One, so this for them won't be good enough, and that's why they are disappointed. But we have to remember that they went down a pathway for 2 seasons straight that was not the right direction, and now they've turned it around. They're starting with a fresh new concept for them, but they've got 2 years to work on, you know. So they, you know, Lewis mentioned in his post-race grab that he learned a lot about the car during the race, and that he thinks that just based off of what he learned there, there's a lot that they can change. So we need to give them a little bit of time to understand the concept that they've got now, and hopefully that will then eventually pay off.
I think it's been summed up perfectly well by my two friends here. I have nothing else to add. In the words of, name your favourite F1 driver at an FIA press conference, yeah, what they said.
Maybe you can answer this then. I saw, and this came under one of our questions that we put up on Twitter. Could F1 get Adrian Newey involved for the new regulations? Could you ever see that happening?
No.
Right. Why not?
Because why would Adrian Newey want to give up one of the biggest motivating factors in his life, and that's the thrill of competition and going out there and being the best and designing the best and being recognized as the best? Maybe if he fancied a legacy to the sport, but why?
In the midst of everything happening at Red Bull though, and all the rumors, and you know, I'll let you guys go into that bit, but could you see Adrian Newey maybe moving to another team in all of this? And could you see the trio of Ferrari, Lewis Hamilton and Adrian Newey being an idea?
Yeah, no. Right, listen, that's a quadrant as well, right? And I'll get onto this in a minute. Because yes, I would love to see that. And I don't know if Lewis has had a chat with Adrian Newey or not, but if he had the chance to get Adrian Newey to go there. Ferrari have been trying to get Adrian Newey for the last few years, and it hasn't quite worked out for whatever reason. And with the situation as it is at Red Bull at the moment, is now a time that Adrian Newey thinks good time to go. And the quadrant, by the way, is not your best chassis man, but you want your best engine man as well. And
you're going to say Cowell.
I'm going to say Andy
Cowell.
Yeah,
say Cowell, aren't
well,
you?
Look, Andy Cowell, the man who was responsible for the Mercedes rocket ship from 2014 onwards, who's worked closely with Lewis Hamilton. They're still friends. They still talk away from the track as well. If you could get Adrian Newey and Andy Cowell to go with you to Ferrari, if you were Lewis Hamilton, wow, What a four-timer that is.
How long would that take to embed in? Like how long
to get Adrian Newey out of a contract? I don't
maybe
know,
not
but
that.
I'd imagine a while.
But how long would it take from him saying yes, or for that whole team saying yes? Obviously, we know Lewis is going, but how long would it take to have an impact on the track? What's the turnaround
If they
time?
Went tomorrow...
2 years.
If they went tomorrow, maybe by the time we get to the start of 2026, yeah, they would have had enough of an influence to have.
I don't think it's as far fetched as we're thinking.
Well, let's on a sporting context. Let's get into this now. Could we be seeing the start of the beginning of the end of Red Bull's setup that has helped their dominance over the years? Because all the talk, all the rumours at the moment are, is Max Verstappen looking for a way out to maybe go to Mercedes where there's a free seat in 2025? And why would he want to do that?
Because it starts, doesn't it, now? This is it. People are beginning just the elements are moving, aren't they, for 2020? That we know for 2026, people are starting to think about it. And I just wonder if all of what's been happening, is Max going to go to Mercedes?
And look, we should just say, Red Bull have said the team are united. These aren't just rumours.
And 2026, by the way, for those that are thinking why that particular year, new regulations when it comes to engines, new sustainable fuels and new engines. And the rumours are, and my phone has just pinged in the background there, which is probably someone else I know. There it goes
again. More breaking news.
Saying, yeah, Red Bull engine for 2026. The rumours are it's not that good. And those rumours are out there.
I've heard rumours that they are good. It is good. It's been on the dyno and everything looks
rumors.
It's an amazing.
Yeah. So it's rumours though.
It's rumours. Yeah.
There's my phone again.
There's a lot of breaking news on your phone.
Adrian Newey.
Wow.
Stop recording.
I'm off to Ferrari.
Actually, it's Craig Slater. And Craig Slater, our super scoop. There he goes again. He knows all the rumours.
Yes,
to be honest. I can't tell you this one. But look, if that engine, let's just say it. What if that engine for 2026 at Red Bull is not good or they don't think it's going to be that good, Max is tied in for 26, 27 and 28 in his current contract, unless he has some sort of clause to get him out early, whatever that clause may be.
Which, as we know from Lewis's contract with Mercedes, it's very possible.
It's always clauses.
Yeah.
And one former team principal, now CEO, said to me, during the off-season, the power is all with the drivers at the moment. Drivers are signing up for long-term contracts full of clauses. Because, and especially if you're a top driver, you've got the advantage. Teams want you, and you know that you can get your way. Lewis has gone to Ferrari, and I'm sure he's on a much better terms than he was at Mercedes, because Ferrari were desperate to have him. So those clauses are there, and we're all speculating. But why would Jos Verstappen be stood in the paddock talking to Toto Wolff so publicly? Why would he go and have dinner, as has been reported, with Toto Wolff in Bahrain?
Sorry? Leverage. You want leverage, don't you?
Yeah.
I mean, that's an important thing. If you've got an offer from another team and you can bring that to your existing team, as even for a negotiation tactic, that could also be a strong point or a reason why we might be doing that. But we've learned this weekend that actually, despite everything that's happening off of the track, it hasn't harmed their performance. And as long as that car is powerful, quick, dominant, why would you look anywhere else? And yes, as you say, if the car is looking to not be that way after 26, then that could be a reason to start, you know, placing your eggs in other baskets.
Right now it's January. Sorry, it was not January. Right now it's March of 2024. And we're talking about things that are going to impact 2026. Yep. It's a unique sport, isn't it? Because it is.
You have to think ahead.
You have to think ahead.
And that's what they're doing. And that's what the Verstappens are doing. That's what Jos is doing. People are getting their ducks in a row early, because you've got to. If you want to win championships from 2026 and beyond, now is the time.
And why is it important? Max is young enough to carry on beyond 28. Why would 26, 27, 28 be so important to him? Because he's made no secret of his desire to end his F1 career in 2028 and go off and do something else. So it's maximising, no pun intended, his opportunities and his chances whilst he's in the sport.
However, that's based on his current contract. So it would be quite interesting to see when he... if and when he makes a move to another team, what the end of that contract will be. and whether he's still sticking to the goal of 28. I think 28 was just because that's the end of his current contract.
Yeah, but I think that we know Max, he wants to go racing in some way, shape or form. And if he's not racing in reality, he's racing on, you know, a
set. Virtually, sure.
And he's happy doing that. So make the money as fast as you can and as much as you can, and then get out and allow yourself to be a family man, to have a little less time at the racetrack, to pursue other interests as well. Wouldn't surprise me one day to see Max Verstappen at Le Mans. Might even want to give Indy a go. You know, he loves racing. Mm. You know, on a weekend off, he'll go and hire a racetrack and zoom around in Porsches with his dad. You know, and he loves that sort of thing. We go and take our sons for a kick around in the park, and you know, Max takes his dad for a drive around a racetrack. And has as much enjoyment doing that as he does racing a Formula One car. That's the guy. He's just a racer. He loves it.
One thing I think we can say is this story is not done, is it? I think it's going to evolve in Saudi Arabia this week, and it's going to keep going and keep going and keep going over the next few months and well into the season. So I'm sure it will keep developing. It maybe even since recording this podcast, your phone's been going off. Maybe there's been some more developments. Who knows? But yes, let's move on to our mailbag section.
Thank you, Matt. That's really fun.
We can talk about some other things now. This is the mailbag section. So questions from people at home. And
when you say mailbag,
yeah.
Does anyone actually post a letter anymore?
No, it is.
What is your address? Yeah,
if you metaphorical
want,
mailbag.
What, if you'd like to send a postcard to this podcast, we'd love that. Actually.
Yeah, we would.
Let's go retro for a bit. Matt Baker, if you put TV's Matt Baker on there, it'll get to
him.
It will get to him.
It will find him.
Yeah, somehow it will find its
Matt
way.
Matt Baker, Sky Studios, Grant Way, Austerly, Middlesex, TW7, 5QD.
Look at you.
And it will get to him.
Thank you very much. And you know what? There's actually quite a lot of posts in the office for you guys. Well, there's a big stack of post.
Well, we ought to go into the office occasionally.
Yeah. We need to go get our post.
Yeah, you should come. We'd love to have you.
Please, send as many postcards in.
With that bird on the front.
White cheek.
The white.
Yeah, and if you've got a picture of the white-cheeked bulbul, we'd like to see that. But send as many postcards as you can, especially before the price of a stamp goes up, right, to TV's Matt Baker, Sky Studios, Grant Way, Austerly, Middlesex, TW7, 5QD.
That is actually the postcode.
Yeah, that's a very good memory you've got of the Sky address.
Once upon a time, TV programmes always gave out their address. Yeah, and Box, I think we're lacking in that.
Yeah.
Okay, let's
I like
some
ferrets,
questions.
By the way. So if you can have a postcard of a ferret, that would be excellent.
All animals welcome. Naomi, favourite animal while we're here?
Elephant.
Yeah, nice. Lovely.
Yeah, they're quite good.
Anyway, back to the jumbo post bag.
Yeah, I'm really going to bring this back down to reality. Right. How did Lewis's seat break? Does anyone have any intel on what this was?
When have you ever known a seat break in the middle?
I've never had a seat break at all.
Unless they're trying to make the seats even lighter because cars, you know, weight is a problem.
Good theory.
And they're maybe not reinforcing them quite the way they used to. And if that is a complete guess.
You're making that up. No, we don't know the answer to that, Matt. No one knows the answer.
It's not been a great start.
What I did hear, though, is that one side of it was completely missing. So it broke and then it kind of dropped, it sank, but his body couldn't, because obviously one side of his body was still on the seat. Apparently his left butt cheek was in the air.
It's good for the glutes.
He said it himself. There's quotes out there somewhere. Really? Yep.
Great intel.
Yeah. Seriously. And that's now the clickbait headline for the podcast. Hamilton butt cheek chat. And I am kind of surmising, I'm not making it up. Last year we saw aerodynamic parts fail on cars because they hadn't been reinforced enough because teams were trying to save weight. So that's where that educated guess
comes
from.
You can look at the seat.
He's so clever. You're so clever.
Right, next question. What did you make of Yuki and Daniel racing on the in-lap? Bit of context for this. Tsunoda was trying to overtake Magnussen for 12th place. Then the team told Ricardo, or said to Ricardo, you can overtake. He was on faster tyre compound and let him challenge Magnussen. Tsunoda was not happy about that. And then on the in-lap, so obviously the lap where you're no longer racing, you're just coming to go back into the pits to bring the car in. It all got a bit dicey.
Oof.
Who's got a view on this?
Well, let the racer go first.
Yeah.
It's always frustrating when your team come on the radio and say, driver swap, which is what they said, by the way. They didn't cover it up with strat B, C, D, F, whatever. They just said driver swap. And from that moment onwards, Yuki was not very happy. I think he was on used hards, was he, at the end? And Daniel was on either fresher tires or a different set. Yes, exactly. So given the fact that he had multiple laps to get past Kevin, I mean, they weren't exactly fighting for points anyway, but every position counts. I think it was fair enough for the team to make that request at that point. Yuki obviously didn't feel the same way. And you could, you know, we've seen Yuki in the past. When he gets frustrated, it's quite loud. It's quite colorful. And it just played out on track. And I think he's really got to be careful with that kind of stuff, because the team have warned him about it in the past. They've been vocal about that. Last year, it seemed like he took a real step forward in that sense. He kind of matured a lot, took the lead role in the team. I think maybe he feels a bit threatened with Daniel in the team. You know, there's a lot of talks about Daniel being there to potentially get the Red Bull seat. And I think he feels slightly overlooked. So he's just got to find a way to deal with that frustration, because doing things like that on track is not going to help. And the more you can rein in your anger and manage the situation, the better it's going to be for him on track as well.
I think that's going to be one of the intra team rivalries that kicks off this year.
One of many.
And again, going back to why this year could be good, is because so many drivers, 13 of them, are out of contract at the end of 2024. And if you are in the Racing Bull, Visa Cash Out, whatever they're called, Racing Bulls, you know that you're potentially in the best position to have a go and have a crack at the seat next to Max next year, if Sergio's not going to stay, or if they're not going to renew his contract. So I think tensions are going to be high, and they're high already, and it's started.
I have a modicum of sympathy for... No, I have more than a modicum of sympathy for Yuki Tsunoda during the race. He's four tenths behind Kevin Magnussen. He's got DRS, and the team say, yeah, let Daniel through. Now, I'm not sure I'd be that obliging at that point either. It was a clumsy time to try and engineer a swap. I have less sympathy for what happened after the race, but in the heat of the moment, athletes, sports people do things that they wouldn't normally do when they've got a calm, clear, level head. But Lauren Mekies, the new team principal, fine team principal in the making, I think, there. Very intelligent man, very calm man. Needs to get both drivers together to say, right, you've had your chance now. Next time, right, you do what we say, because we've got all the data. You don't get all het up about it. And I don't want to see anything like that after the race, because that was just silly.
Who's got the edge between those two, do you think?
Daniel's got winning experience. Yuki, I think, has got massive potential to unlock. I really do. And I think they're converging to quite similar abilities at this stage in their career. I really do.
And over this weekend, Yuki was, on average, quicker than Daniel.
Yeah.
I love Yuki.
So do I. I do love Yuki.
He's such a character. He's brilliant for the sport.
He's brilliant for the sport.
His messages over team radio are just, they're classics. So.
Do you think now Tosta's gone? Tosta seemed to get a handle on it.
He was a more fearsome presence, I think.
Yeah, I think he might have been. It's a lot for Lauren Mekies to deal with in his opening few months.
But he's also got Alan Permain with him as sporting director, who's been around a long, long time.
It's going to be entertaining. It's going to be entertaining, isn't it?
He's also had somewhat of a revolving door of performance coaches over the last couple of years. And I think sometimes that's what you need. You know, you travel a lot. You're on the road alone. You've got the pressures of whatever it is, whether it's your teammates putting you under pressure or the team making decisions that you don't like or whatever it is. That person can usually be the one who you vent to or get those frustrations released, discuss how you deal with them. And I don't know who his performance coach is now, but he did have Michael Italiano last year. And I know that that was something that they were really heavily working on, was managing Yuki's emotions in the car. So hopefully that's not going to change. Because I think, you know, as we say, he's got so much potential. He's such a great character. And you wouldn't want something as trivial as that to be his downfall or his demise in this particular pairing right now.
Yeah, definitely. I've got another question for you, Naomi, actually.
Okay.
From the mailbag.
From the mailbag.
Was it specifically addressed to
Naomi? It wasn't, but I want to come to you on it. If the domination from Red Bull Racing is to continue, what effect could it have for younger drivers wanting to make it to F1? Could it possibly put them off the sport and have them looking at other series like IndyCar, Formula E or WEC before Formula One?
No.
No. You think Formula One is still the pinnacle?
Formula One
for
is
every
absolutely
driver,
the
yeah.
pinnacle of motorsports, regardless of the results on track. And I think, you know, just the everything that comes with it. It's what you dream of growing up as a kid. That's where you want to get to. And I don't think that the on-track racing, I mean, there were phases in my career when I was really young where Formula One was extremely boring as well. Mm. And it didn't put me off of it. You still, it's still, you know, you want to be that hero, you know, that you don't wear a cape, you wear a race suit, but to be in Formula One is really what these drivers dream of. And of course, there's multiple other championships out there that are fantastic, and there are only 20 seats in the world. I think that's a bigger issue, is drivers yeah. having really long contracts right now. There's not enough open doors for young talent to come through, and there's a lot of, you know, great drivers sitting in the bleachers right now that should have a seat in Formula One. Not to say that the ones on the grid right now shouldn't, but there maybe should be something looked into how that can be better managed going forwards.
Once upon a time, Nigel Mansell was winning races by, you know, 3 seconds a lap faster than anyone else. We don't look back on that period and go, God, wasn't it dull? We go, oh, wasn't Mansell just great? But you make a really good point. You're Felipe Drugovich. You're Jack Doohan. Drugovich, F2 champion. Yeah, you're sat on the sidelines again. You know, and yes, there are 13 drivers out of contract for next season, but
it's a good F2 grid. It's a good F2 grid, by the way, isn't it?
Yeah.
This year.
I think Jack Doohan could get a seat next year because I think the situation at Alpine might not tempt Gasly and Ocon to stay around beyond the end of their contract. But where does Felipe Drugovic go?
Mm. Aston. Stay at Aston. Those two drivers are potentially not staying either.
Fernando's potentially not staying yet. Lance, as discussed in previous podcasts. Felipe Drugovic is not going to get in at Aston Martin. Because unless Fernando and Lance both leave and...
Williams was an option for him last year, wasn't it?
Yeah, but I don't think Williams would be an option next year, to be honest.
Where would he go?
And they can't attract
Haas.
A Carlos Sainz, for instance, at Aston Martin, who I think, if I were them, I would absolutely be aggressively approaching Carlos yeah. Sainz for next year. But I don't see Felipe Drugovic fitting into their future plans. Haas, potentially, but they've Ollie Bearman as reserve yep. driver there. And I think through the Ferrari Academy links, he'll be earmarked there if Magnussen and Hülkenberg both or one drop out. Williams, look, there's a lot of talk about Andrea Kimi Antonelli for Mercedes. Let's go back to the Max Verstappen story. If Mercedes get Max Verstappen, they want to put Andrea Kimi Antonelli in somewhere. That might be a 2-year deal down at Williams.
That is a fascinating lineup.
As well as I know James Vowles, yeah, he is not going to say, even with such a great relationship with Toto Wolff, yeah, I'll take your guy for a year. That's not part of his methodology for Williams. It's about the long term, and it's not about temporary short fixes.
And James Vowles was also an integral part of that junior program.
He knows,
and so he knows Kimi Antonelli very well.
Very well.
So this could be.
And rates him very highly, but I don't think he'd take him for a year.
Very good. Well, I think that's all we have time for.
Have you run out of mail now?
There are a few more in the mailbag, but
you've only got three this week.
Yeah. So we only got three this week.
Get your ferrets in, everybody.
More mail next week so that Matt, when he gets back from Jeddah, spends the first morning opening
sifting
the mail.
Through posts.
I would love to
ferret,
see a
ferret postcard yeah. mail.
I want to see a picture of you surrounded by mail.
We can set that up in the mailroom at Sky.
And ferrets.
Yeah, yeah. Just time to tell you about the timings for this week. We are on our way to Saudi Arabia. So we're going to be on air on Thursday for FP1. Still talking about the ferrets. On FP1 at 1 p.m, followed, of course, by FP2. Building up to qualifying on Friday from 10 past 4 before a 3:30 on air for a 5 o'clock race on Saturday. Still a Saturday race this week.
So send your letters before the race on Saturday.
Make sure you do. When's everyone travelling to Saudi Arabia?
Tomorrow evening at
Tuesday,
evening. 6 p.m. We're on
Very
a flight.
Nice.
My first time in Saudi.
Travel plans to you.
I have one last question before we go. I've never been to Saudi before, so...
You'll love it.
What should I be looking forward to next week?
What should you be looking forward to? Do you know what? You and
Very
I...
Very fast let's, track.
Let's take a little stroll along the Corniche and go and have some... There's a particularly lovely fried chicken spot on the Corniche that I can take you to.
Crofty, you and I are getting married this year. There's no more fried chicken.
No, more not fried together. Chicken. That's
probably should not clarify that. I'd like to clear up that Naomi and David Goff aren't married.
What was that about
other.
Clickbait?
And on that bombshell.
Yeah.
But it's always been hospitable and a warm welcome. Mm. The track is fantastic.
Extremely fast track. When you look at it and you compare it to things like Baku. Baku's obviously a very quick street circuit, but this one with the kind of changes of direction, it's quite tight as well. It's you know, some might say dangerous, but I think it's a really, you know, it's a very, very slick track. And I think the drivers quite enjoy it, actually.
Yeah, definitely. Should we get in the pool?
Yeah.
Let's go.
Your joke is freezing.
The sun's gone, though.
I know we're sat here in
shorts. I don't think we're going to get much sympathy from people at home.
It's not that warm in Bahrain.
No, it is not that warm in Bahrain.
We'll be next year.
Yeah, moving later in the calendar. Right, everyone. Crofty, Naomi, Simon, thank you very much.
Thank you, Matthew.
Thank you, Matthew.
No, thanks for coming.
By the way, you had dirty trainers on last week. You've got a dirty sock on this week.
Don't ruin the illusion. If you'd like to send socks with your ferret letters, that would be most most welcome. Maybe ferret socks. Who knows? We're going to be back next Monday. Hope you can join us then. Bye for now.